Welcome to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers kiosk from the floor of AUSA. I am honored to be part of 3 days of discussions with key USACE leaders. Today we'll explore how the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers plays a vital role in supporting our nation and our warfighters while also tackling some of the toughest engineering challenges. As part of that story is the Corps' rapid and decisive response to the tragic collapse of Baltimore's Francis Scott Keybridge earlier this year. We'll take a closer look at the Army engineer capabilities and innovations that were crucial to that mission and how those same capabilities are used every day to serve both the American public and our military men and women. Let me introduce our speakers today. Lieutenant General William Butch Graham, 56th Chief of Engineers and Commanding General of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Sir? Colonel Estee Pinchasin, 69th Commander of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and Baltimore District. Ma'am? And Mr. Daniel Visone, Acting Director of the U.S. Army Geospatial Center and also serves as the Geospatial Information Officer on the Army staff. Sir? General Graham, will you kick us off today?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. I want to start off by saying our hearts go out to everyone who was impacted by the two hurricanes that impacted Florida, Georgia, Carolinas, and Virginia. We've got, as we speak today, 300 Corps of Engineers teammates and our contracting partners helping the good folks of around Asheville, North Carolina, and Florida, from Orlando to Jacksonville, all the way over in through the Tampa area, helping folks recover from these terrible storms. We're awfully proud of all that you do. We ask you to stay safe out there as you do it. So today we're going to talk about a previous disaster response we had, and that was a terrible tragedy when the dolly knocked or ran into the piers holding up the Key Bridge, and the amazing work that the entire Corps team, the entire Army team did, working within a larger framework from our state, local, and federal partners to open up that tremendous economic engine known as the Port of Baltimore.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am, can you walk us through this disaster response and how did you approach this mission?
Well, as you heard from General Graham just now, responding is instinctual for the Corps. It's what we do. We show up no matter what role we're needed at the time. When the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapsed in that early morning of March 26th, the role we assumed was in support of the incident commander, which at the time was the Maryland Transportation Authority Police, who were in the middle of a search and rescue operation. We provided highly qualified structural engineers who had valuable urban search and rescue experience to support the Maryland State Police divers as they were looking for the missing construction workers. But by that evening, when it was clear that we weren't going to find any survivors, we transitioned to a recovery operation, search and recovery, continued to provide that support to the divers to make sure they were going into safe locations as they were searching, and at the same time had a parallel line of effort for the overarching mission, which we would have, which is to open the Federal Navigation Channel, reopen the Port of Baltimore. For that, we had to leverage the United States Navy Supervisor of Salvage, which we did. We activated a pre-existing inter-service support agreement that enabled us to leverage the salvage expertise within the Navy, but most importantly, our industry partners. In the Corps, we don't do anything alone. We are able to pull in personnel, experts from every field, from anywhere in the country, around the Corps, in DOD, our interagency partners. And for this mission, pulling in the experts in the salvage industry was going to be essential. So we were able to do that with our Navy. There's true power in that. We also, besides having the right tools, we had to have the right structure. And that's really the beauty of the incident command system, where you're able to tailor your organization for the mission that you have at hand. So we were able to pull in not only core experts, whether it was our emergency managers, our public affairs team, to be able to really commit, along with Governor Wes Moore, to be transparent, especially for the families of the missing construction workers, to all the Marylanders, the thousands of Marylanders that were impacted by this tragedy. We brought in our regulatory team, who were already working, and the planners, looking to the future for rebuilding the bridge, all our debris, our surveyors, our debris collectors, supporting the entire effort. Another really key thing, we always felt that we had all 40,000 of the Corps of Engineers people behind us, but one of the really great examples wasn't just what we brought to bear on site, it was the reach back capability that we had. We leveraged the Engineer Research and Development Command in order to help us generate some options. There was a point where we had to pivot. We needed to have the agility to adjust a plan as the situation developed. We had to shift our focus away from that large span that was sitting on the vessel, because the stored energy in that span was so dangerous that we decided we needed to use controlled demolition or explosives. So as we were developing that demo plan, we shifted the effort across the channel to open what we called the limited access channel. It would allow to provide some relief for the port, getting about 70 to 80% of the traffic that we could through. And to do that, we leveraged ERDC, the Engineer Research and Development Command, who helped with a simulation. We sent the Maryland pilots down to Vicksburg, Mississippi, so they were able to validate the dimensions that were needed. So as the salvors cleared that, they're working on the demolition at the same time. It's absolutely, absolutely essential. Another key area was the Army Geospatial Center, who helped support the common operating picture for the more than 1,500 people that came through that incident command post supporting that response by creating a great visualization of the problem we were facing.
Partnership is key, and that's awesome. So you were talking about the key takeaways. Were there any more takeaways that you that made this successful?
I think that the unity of effort, what we did to come together, we had the support of everyone, whether it was state, local, federal, the bipartisan support, not just of the Maryland congressional delegation, but the entire Congress, the military chains of command from the Navy, the Army, Coast Guard, Department of Homeland Security, the entire team. And then, of course, having, I think, the most meaningful support was from the local Baltimoreans and Marylanders, who, having their trust and confidence in what we were doing, probably was the most meaningful of all.
Fantastic. Well, Mr. Visone, so we're now going to learn about AGC. So can you share, for those who do not know, what is the Army Geospatial Center?
Sure. And actually, one of the things you said about the COP, the underpinning of a common operational picture is geospatial data. It is truly the foundation. Geography is a great way to organize information, because everything is somewhere at some time, right? So our mission on behalf of General Graham as a topographer of the Army is to build and manage the authoritative geospatial foundation for all Army programs, right? That's the underpinning. And we do that through data collection. We have assets that collect globally, high resolution, three-dimensional data and imagery, all unclassified. We do it by curating that foundation so all the systems have the right information at the right time. And we do it through helping field systems that become data collectors. So the survey kits for the engineers, the engineer recon kits. We field the GeoInt workstations so the geospatial engineers at the tactical level can collect and manage that foundation. And we provide guidance to all Army systems on implementing the right standards, the right data models, the right profiles, so all those systems are geospatially interoperable.
So that brings up a good point. So when it came to the Keybridge response, what did AGC bring to the table?
So two main things, and again, we mentioned the common operational picture. So we had people on site connecting all the data. Everything was about the data, and as long as it was geospatially enabled, connecting it through a COP to provide visualization to the senior leaders. Not only did we do it up in Baltimore, but our organization is in charge of the USACE Common Operational Picture, UCOP, and we provided the connection to all that data to all the senior leaders, building customized dashboards to provide the decision makers the information they needed. And then the second big part was collecting the data. So we did two overflies with our Buckeye system with LiDAR, high resolution 3D data and imagery. So we collected the area, a big broad area for Baltimore as the foundation. And then we did multiple drone collects as debris was being removed, so you could provide the decision makers an update on what was actually happening. And a lot of our imagery eventually was shown to the President of the United States, especially when the boat was removed, because it all became about providing pretty much dynamic mapping information to show what was going on.
Well, so can you talk about some ways that AGC helped support our warfighters?
Sure. So and actually, I would say 99% of what our mission is to support the warfighter. And again, it is to ensure that all the Army programs, Intel, Mission Command, Army Futures Command systems, the next generation C2, all have the right maps at the right time. I like to say, if you think of a living digital twin, from bathymetric to subterranean to dense urban to open and rolling, how do you continually update that data with the right information, with the right currency, accuracy, and attribution to support operations at every echelon? And that is our job, to provide that authoritative foundation.
Thank you. Sir, would you like some closing? Can you close us out?
Well, so let me ask, is it time to quiz Colonel Pinchasin?
Absolutely, I think so. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. So,
buckle up.
There used to be two corps of engineers. Do you know that story?
Two corps?
Two corps of engineers.
I don't.
Yeah, so from the 1830s to the 1860s, we were split into two. We had the Corps of Topographic Engineers, and we had what we still call the Corps of Engineers, because there was that much work relying on the Army cartographers, geographers, to explore the Louisiana Purchase, to understand where the best routes to move this new nation towards the west. And yeah, they were actually two Corps of Engineers. You go down to our museum, Dr. Lundquist down there has some neat old artifacts from back in the day. So it's wonderful to still have within the engineer family, the Corps of Engineers family, this absolutely key capability to understand what the terrain is. Sitting here in the middle of AUSA, where this is all about warfighting, the old adages going back to Sun Tzu still stand. Know yourself, know the enemy, and know the terrain. And understanding the terrain is a key responsibility of the Army Geospatial Center. So we appreciate the professionalism and how well you do that work for the warfighters, as well as when we need that capability to understand what's going on. And those mosaic pictures of what that bridge wreckage looked like below the water, above the water, telling that story of what the Navy Supervisor Salvage were doing was absolutely, absolutely critical. So we thank you both for all of that great work. So, Estee, to you, AGC, and the entire team who got that port opened back up, we're awfully, awfully proud of that entire team. It was amazing, but we're most proud of that you did it safely. And for everybody who's in support of the hurricane relief operations for Hurricane Helene and Hurricane Milton, I was down Wednesday with a lot of our USACE teammates in North Carolina watching the great work in action. They had 17 generators that were on the side of those hills helping to restart society, basically, for those communities that were impacted. We know General Kwan is up there right now leading the recovery effort for Hurricane Helene, and we have General Hibner down in Florida as we speak, working to help Florida get back on its feet. So thanks to the Baltimore team, the entire team, for all the great work that they did on the Keybridge. And thanks for everybody who's responding currently and everybody back in the home districts who's picking up the slack for those folks who are able to volunteer. We appreciate everything that you're doing.
Sir, thank you. Thank you all for joining us today. I've learned a lot. I hope you enjoyed learning more about the incredible work the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is doing to support both our nation and our military. Be sure to stop by the USACE kiosk here at AUSA Army Exhibit Booth 1825 to see some of the exciting technologies we've discussed today up close. And don't forget to tune in tomorrow. We've got more exciting topics that's lined up. And thanks again, and we'll see you soon.